right, so this is the time of the night where I turn things over to Mark to introduce our speaker. Only tonight is a twist.
Don't move, all right? Tonight's program is with our featured presenter. She is offering a reboot of her very first presentation to the W.A.S. A look at the myth-enshrouded origins of the zodiac and its key constellations, with an aim at debunking some hoary and entertaining legends and misperceptions. If you ever explain to an audience that the stars of Libra used to be the claws of the great scorpion and wondered in the back of your head what the zodiac looked like back then, this is for you. Those are two of my favorite star names too. And she'll tell you what they are. She is currently our president of the Warren Astronomical Society and also of the Great Lakes Association of Astronomy Clubs. She likes binocular astronomy and has a Space Shuttle plush toy in her room. She and her spouse and observing partner, Jonathan Kade, are now officially hooked on total solar eclipses and hope to travel to Chile in 2019. Presenting Echoes of Ancient Skies Revisited, the one and only Diane Hall.
All right. Can I have the little bit more light? It's a little scary when I can't see anybody. That's better. All right. So, I grew up in a household that was a blend of science and mysticism. All of my interests in bugs, dinosaurs, the constellations were actually encouraged. But my family believed very strongly in ghosts and Ouija boards and that the house was haunted. So astronomy and astrology kind of existed side by side in my household. I learned the names of the stars in Leo, but at the same time, I learned that I was a Leo by virtue of being born on August 19th, and this meant something. And so what did it mean? And so this attempting to reconcile the mystical side of my upbringing with the scientific bent that I had lasted 4 years, and it led me into some strange places that we'll touch on later, and places I don't necessarily recommend going, but I can get you a list of books if you're so inclined. So, 9 years ago, my first presentation to the Society was sparked by the phrase, Leo is believed to be one of the 6 constellations in the original primeval zodiac. And that fired my imagination. Ooh, primeval zodiac, 6 constellations, ancient ideas about the sky. Okay, what's up with that? Well, we know the classical zodiac changed over the years and was one key component. So one of the astronomy tidbits that I do like to throw out during laser sky tours is that Libra, the constellation of the scales or the balance, once formed the 2 claws of Scorpius the Scorpion, as indicated by the name of the stars, like Mark said, Zubin Alganubi, Zubin Escamali, northern claw, southern claw, it's there. Well, zodiac means critters, zoo. This was, so we say, a late Roman inanimate abstract addition to the celestial zoo. Needed a 12th sign. Balance of justice. Cool thing. Very Roman. Not primeval. So, okay. So we had this sign added to get a 12 constellation zodiac. All right, fine. So what did it look like before that? Where do we go from there? So I started off researching, trying to get to the bottom of the story of the 6 constellations of Zodiac. So, okay, we've got Leo. So what were the other 5? Who came up with it? When did they come up with it? This turns out to be a really dangerous ground to start researching, especially once the internet is at your fingertips. Because I read some weird stuff when I was in high school, and the internet was not on every device. Okay, well now it is, and you start looking for primeval zodiac, you start looking for roots of the zodiac, who came up with the zodiac, you do not want to know what you will find. But here's what I found and what I will share with you. So, fair warning. Yes, this is going to touch on astrology. I've given you guys the astrology talk. Y'all know that astrology and astronomy have intertwined roots the same way that modern chemistry has its roots in alchemist cells, going all the way up to the age of Isaac Newton, by the way. So, astronomy and astrology have been intertwined for most of human history. Trace far enough in time, one bangs into the other. And the intersection between the hard science of astronomy and astrology is actually a fun way to illustrate or illuminate how weird things can get when scholars decide that they're going to substitute wishful thinking for facts. So put on your safari hats because we're going on a little zoo trip. So what's a zodiac? For the purposes of discussing things tonight, we're going to talk about a tropical zodiac such as they use in the Greco-Roman quote-unquote classical tradition. The points of reference are visible nodes called tropics. They are turning points at which the sun at sunrise and sunset appear to turn. Move along the horizon after the winter solstice, move along the southern horizon after the summer solstice. So this is we think of it as a very Greek system, as you can tell from the names of many of the stars and constellations involved. It's continued by the Romans, who allegedly added Libra, and it's still in use by American and Western European astrologers. There are other zodiacs, but they don't involve Leo the Lion, so we're not talking about those tonight. So I've got some books, interesting books. I got a lot from my mother, who was into the occult. One of them is called R.H. Allen's Star Names That Lore Meaning. And if you want to delve into the etymology of just about anything up there in the sky, every star with a Greek alphabet designation, every constellation, including the ones that don't exist anymore, this is a good starting point. The information is there. Now, the scholarship, and well, you know, it's a fairly old book, and some of our standards for rigorous methodology today enforce that. So, entertaining read, but you gotta be careful about believing everything you do read on. Well, Allen had the six constellation primordial zodiac. Right there on the first page of the book, actually, when I went looking for it, like, oh, hey, gold mine. Except his constellations were Taurus, okay, Cancer, Virgo. Okay, Scorpius, yeah, fine. Capricornus and Pisces, no Leo. So I strike out the very first source. Anyway, so he goes on to say that the existence of 12 full moons throughout the year, normally, led to each of these six ancient signs being subdivided. Okay, fine. Seemed a little weird to me that Cancer was one of them, because no offense to any of you who might be have a star sign of Cancer, but that is easily the least impressive of the zodiacal constellations. So that would be something that the ancients would latch on was a little weird to me. Anyway, I didn't find what I was looking for, so I kept looking. So let's go back to the library thing. Since that's something that you think, all right, Roman times, we ought to be able to get a paper trail on this. So, there's a guy named Servius. He's writing in AD 400, Common Era 400. He writes at the time, okay, he's saying that there was an 11 constellation zodiac in Greco-Roman culture, and Scorpius, this big sprawling thing, was a double sign. Okay, this illustration is from much later. It's actually from Mercator's Atlas. But it gives you the sense. It's a big sprawling critter with two huge outstretched claws. Makes sense, fine. Okay. So I kept looking. The original six, was it Taurus, Leo, Gemini, Cancer, Libra, and Scorpius? No, that doesn't make any sense. Nobody could believe that. What, Libra and Scorpius? No, we know that's not it. Taurus, Leo, Virgo, Sagittarius, Aries, and Capricornus. Okay, that's got Leo. It's also got some weird things about it. Anyway, long story short, I read a lot. Nobody agreed with anyone. Nobody could trace anything back to actual facts, actual paper trail, anything that made sense. So at this point, I got off the track of finding the primordial zodiac, and I started asking myself, how did this get so messed up? That, as it happens, has a very detailed paper trail. So, you get movements of thought in science and philosophy and medicine Sometimes movements of thought are very powerful, and they attract adherents, and the adherents feed off one another, and they write a lot of papers, or back then monographs, or they publish a lot of things, and they reinforce one another, and they're very, very wrong. This is what happened. Misinformation about the zodiac isn't coming out of nowhere. A great deal of it comes from a handful of German scholars who were active at the end of the 8th, 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, basically the years leading up to World War I. Their school is called Pan-Babylonism, and they have a couple of core tenets. All myths, Hebrew myths, Egyptian myths, Mesopotamians, all of them are concerned entirely with astral phenomena. Like, this is the key to understanding human culture, okay? And the whole cosmological system was all derived from Babylon specifically, where it was fully developed 3,000 years before the Common Era. So we're talking very far back in history. After the Great Pyramids, mind you, but really far back in history. And then from Babylon, this influence extended over the entire world. Okay, so this is some pretty heady stuff. This is very sophisticated claims as to what was going on in Babylon 5,000 years ago. No. Okay. We have tablets, we have documents, we have a lot of evidence that when looked at a little more rigorously, there's Babylonian astronomy, absolutely. It goes through three phases. We'll go into a little bit more detail about them later, but it starts off in the third millennium before the Common Era with pretty simple stuff. There's names of things, names and mythic attributes. Okay. Then it gets systematic, gets into simple mathematics, starts talking about positions. Then, another millennia down the line, you start getting into predictive astronomy, you start getting into theory. Okay, that makes a little more sense. It takes a long time for this to unfold. So, at that point, you can safely say, no, there's no complete zodiac, no sophisticated zodiac in 4000 BC, not the way that we're thinking about it. So, these guys had it wrong, really wrong. They abused arguments from analogy. They used antiquated translations that were known to be not very good even at the time. They ignored the evidence in front of them if it didn't meet their preconceived ideas, and they went off on speculative tangents. They thought they were doing science. They were doing really bad science. And they're dating for some things like, say, King Sargon. Some of you may have heard of him as, you know, Akkadian rulers go. He's probably the main one that comes to mind. Their date for his reign was about 1,300 years off. So if you're trying to calculate based on when Sargon was king, you're going to get really screwed up really fast with a 1,300-year error. Well, okay, so we say this school of thought lasted up until 1914. Well, there's a little problem. Bad habits don't go away. Bad ideas don't go away. And the core of it may be these German scholars, but they had friends. They had friends in the US, they had friends in the UK, they had friends in Bulgaria. There's some Bulgarian sources that were way post-day World War I. And the occult gets into it, and some fringy stuff gets involved, and this stuff propagates. Because it's fun, it's interesting. It can be kind of offensive. I mean, you go up to somebody who is Jewish and you say, hey, did you know you stole your whole holy book from the Babylonians? Yeah. But that's what they were doing. That was some of the tenets. And some people found it edgy, exciting. And then the rest of it, you know, snowballed. So you can go and find some of the same garbage in bookshelves today, and they don't care that it's been debunked, you know, 103 years ago. Still makes money. A lot of crazy stuff makes money. So even once you kick the Pan-Babylonian stuff to the side, you get into some really evocative ideas about the formation of the zodiacal constellations. And it is primal, powerful imagery. and it gets neatly packaged in something called the Ages of Man. Okay, who's heard of the Age of Aquarius? Raise your hands. Yeah. And what predates the Age of Aquarius?
The
Age of Pisces. Okay? And
the Beatles.
The Beatles, yes. Well, one of the more fanciful claims of the Pan-Babylonists was that astronomy emerged between 6,000 and 5,000 years before the Common Era. So we're talking 8,000 years ago. During the supposed Age of Gemini, when the spring equinox for the Northern Hemisphere, okay, spring and equinox Northern, occurred in the twins. Gemini, okay. So you're demanding the existence of a constellation concept that survived intact for 8,000 years. That's pretty interesting, but a pretty powerful idea. Doesn't have any scholarship supporting it, and neither do the competing claims that the whole system was set up during the Age of Taurus, when about the time of the pyramids, when the spring equinox was in Taurus, and then you had the summer solstice in Leo, and the autumn equinox in Scorpius, and you have these great, beautiful, bold constellations reigning over these kind of appropriate seasons. Again, it makes sense on a certain intuitive level. Yeah, the bull ushers in the spring, the lion reigns over the summer, the big creepy scorpion thing brings the bad weather. Okay. It resonates with people. It resonated with me. I liked these ideas. It's poetic. But it's not verifiable, and in fact, to the extent that you can look into it, it's not even true. And then when you do go looking, you do find all the kind of fringy stuff. So you type Age of Taurus into a search engine. Maybe you want to have incognito window open so it doesn't clutter up your search history forever, but just check it out. So, you know, an astrological age brings a new paradigm of collective thought. So, you know, the Age of Pisces is often taken to be the Age of Christ, because you've got the Christian fish imagery, and then that's going to end, and we'll have the Age of Aquarius, which is long-haired musicals and the fifth dimension and that kind of thing. Yeah. And you'll find that people throw everything into the mix pot. So you've got the Pan-Babylon claims, and you've got the Chinese astronomy mixed in, and maybe the Vedas, and maybe if they're feeling really, really edgy, they're going to bring in Native American. Yeah, you can't just throw everything into the pot and have it work. And then some things that you really do, at least I really did want to believe, kind of zero in on particular epochs in time. So who's heard of the myth of Atlantis? Plato's Atlantis, lost continent. Come on, yeah. All right, so who's heard of the explanation of Atlantis, that it was a big volcanic explosion on what's now known as the island of Santorini? Okay. It's cool. This explosion happened. This island, which was called Thera back in the day, and Santorini now, was basically obliterated by an incredible explosion that has this ejecta blanket that is one of the thickest, most menacing things that we've ever excavated. So we know that there was a massive natural disaster around the age of the Minoan culture, when the Mediterranean had the Cretan Minoan culture, that they had a sophisticated building, they had sewage, they had all kinds of modern conveniences, and then something terrible happened and then all went away. Well, the Santorini explosion may have been that something terrible. You can tie all that into the archaeological record, but when you start piling speculation about how Santorini screwed up astronomy, again, it's pretty resonant stuff, and people have all these neat little schemes as to how this explosion affected this, that, and the other, and had these setbacks in our understanding of the sky. It's cool, but again, do we have evidence? So at this point in my journey to find the truth about the zodiac, I was really frustrated. Once you kick out the course, scholarship, kick out the speculation. What's left? What have I even got to tell you guys? Is any of it true? Is the thing about Libra true? How does the 13th constellation, Ophiuchus, the snake handler, that guy up there, how does he fit into it? Does he fit into it at all? It's there. The sun goes across it. Did anybody ever take that into account? Why? So let's go back to Libra. Romans liked writing things, right? We can find a paper trail on this. As far as we can go back, Egyptian astronomy. There's three brightest stars called a boat. Okay? It's a boat. Well, it turns out Egyptian astronomy has very, very, very little to do with the Babylonian, Mesopotamian, Greco-Roman narrative that we're looking into. So throw the boat away. Turns out Libra is not mentioned by a lot of great sources for a very long time. So this guy, Eudoxus, 4th century before the Common Era, he doesn't mention it. Aratus, guy coming along in 3rd century, he doesn't mention it. First time to really encounter it seems to be a guy called Geminus of Rhodes. So this is Greek landmass area, but Roman influenced culture, 1st century before the Common Era. Okay, so it existed then. And then it shows up as a constellation, Ptolemy's Almagest, which is in our Common Era. Well, maybe there's something in the story that the Romans did invent it. And here's the fun thing about the Romans. They knew what they were doing when they were inventing stories. That's the difference between, if you're into mythology, somebody like the Greek writer Hesiod, who seems to have actually truly believed the myths that he was putting down, and somebody like Ovid in the Roman era, who was writing cool, pretty imagery stories, and yeah, there was a point to them that might have been a little bit political, might have been a little bit topical, but he knew he was crafting stories, and he didn't necessarily believe that anybody had ever been transformed into a star or a tree or a swallow. He was an author. So, you get a guy like Virgil, wrote the Aeneid, got resurrected by Dante in the Divine Comedy to be his buddy in one of the more interesting works of metafiction. He tied the existence of Libra into the death of Julius Caesar. It's propaganda. It's Roman propaganda wrapped up in poetry and the apotheosis of the... He was never an emperor, but the first among equals. And so, yeah, there is a kernel of truth to it. They did invent Libra, and they used it for myth-making ends. And since there was no Libra in the Greek tradition, it seems that people believed, the people writing in the first century, believed that they had conjured this scale out of the zodiac in order to honor this new Roman age. Except that if you look at the etymology of the names of the stars, you find out that Greeks aside, a lot of people had always considered them to be scales or a balance or something similar. So you've got people actually creating myths based off earlier truths to their own end in this never-ending chain of, really, it's propaganda. It's almost funny when you get to this stage of it. So that is the truth about Libra. Yeah, it is invented by the Romans, and it wasn't. It didn't exist for the Greeks, but it existed for everybody else. And it doesn't get me any closer to this whole primeval zodiac thing. So, what, 4 constellations from the quote-unquote age of Taurus? Nope, 6, 11, 17, 18 early constellations. That actually seems to be true. And like the business of Libra, it depends on the narrative you're focusing on. If you want to take a little neat set of facts, the Greeks were doing this and the Romans did this, you can get a nice clean narrative. If you look at the whole scope of the culture, nothing adds up, nothing makes sense. And fortunately, a lot of other people did the research. And then you've got the Egyptians who were doing their own thing entirely until Alexander the Great showed up. So what do we think we know for real? Let's go back to the Sumerian-Akkadian period. So we're talking 3000 BC again. Seem to be 7 or 18 constellations along the path of the moon. Not the path of the sun, the path of the moon. And it's simple descriptive astronomy. The celestial bodies have names. There's informal astronomical knowledge incorporated into myths. Okay. And it's refined through the centuries because there were people whose life work it was to do this stuff. So they did it and they built upon their predecessors. And so, old Babylonian period, they calculate the duration of day and night, the rising and setting of the moon, the appearance and disappearance of Venus, the good stuff. The five classical planets were noted as being wandering planets as opposed to fixed stars. Each one was associated with a god, like Marduk being one of the key gods. They were doing math. The math was fundamentally flawed to the point where some calculations of a particular year would be a month off. So the math was not where it needed to be for things to add up. But they were trying. And hey, you know, give it another 500 years. You start getting exact observations of the rising of stars at dawn. You start getting very rigorous observations of the risings, the culminations and the settings of all kinds of stars, and you start getting astrolabe texts. So we can say that in the Middle Eastern, Mesopotamian, Tigris-Euphrates pot of culture, probably 1150 BCE is where you start seeing real mathematical astronomy. Not 3000, not 6000, 1150. Enter the Assyrians. At this point, we're starting to see the recognition of the zodiac as we think of it today, as a path of the sun, the moon, the planets. In other words, it's marking out the ecliptic. And here you do start seeing the zodiacal constellations, and you start getting really entertaining texts about things like eclipses. Now, keep in mind, astronomy and astrology are intertwined. Predictions about halos around stars or appearances of Jupiter, they are tied into the gods, and they tie into other layers of meaning that don't make any sense to a American in 21st century reading a translation of a translation of a translation. They meant something else to the people. So, a prediction about the sun and the moon being side by side and the sun communicating properly with its father, it's not, you know, as trite as it seems. It made sense to them in a way that five translations down the line, it just looks a bit silly. So I found this entertaining bit about an eclipse. So the eclipse happened, or did it? What did it mean? The king didn't get to see the eclipse. Could anybody verify that this eclipse happened? They sent people out. Was there an eclipse? Was it not an eclipse? What did it mean for the king? And we don't know the end of the story. It was important to them, but since there was no satisfaction in seeing this eclipse from the royal city, the astrologers had to play with the data, package it up, try to make it palatable to the boss. And there's a lot of little nuggets of information like that when you start going through these texts. It's like, people are people. And these horoscopes and predictions and the little cute things and tablets, they all play into human nature as much as they do science. So then we get to the Neo-Babylonian period. Got a picture there of the Ishtar Gate, which is one of the most notable, or a reconstruction of it, one of the most notable features in terms of architecture. This was a lovely age of arts and architecture and science. And it was a key area of zodiacal astronomy. Now look at the dates. We're already closing in on 7th century, 6th century BC. We're getting closing in on, oh hey, the Persian period. Here is where we can confidently say the zodiac was in 12 signs, equally spaced, 30 degrees apiece. This is after the fall of Babylon. I mentioned the Pan-Babylonian school of thought was wrong. It's really wrong. And then come some real fun people. Alexander of Macedon and his tutor Aristotle. Alexander shook things up. Aristotle got a lot of things wrong. I think any of us who have ever dabbled in any branch of science, biology, botany, human anatomy, have had occasion to make fun of him at some point. But his works did mark a shift towards empirical science, a body of knowledge based on the idea that you could only derive knowledge from sensory experience. And this era focuses on mathematical science based on actual observations. You've got, at this point, 300 years before the Common Era, you're seeing mathematical theories of motion based on observations. And so the golden age of astronomy in this region, it wasn't some misty, far-off time before the Santorini explosion where the ancients knew something that we'll never know. It was in the Hellenistic period, which, you know, various sources tell us, oh, Greek culture's been corrupted, Egyptian culture's been corrupted, the Romans are everywhere, everything's degenerate. Yeah, but they were doing good science. And you start getting really cool people like this guy, who is a proponent not only of a heliocentric universe, but an infinite universe. People who, they may have got there by the wrong reasoning, but they were surprisingly accurate about the world that we're in. So the true golden age of Babylon was after the Greeks showed up. And about that 12 constellation zodiac, and at this point, the ride was very fun, but I didn't even care about Leo the Lion by the time I got done waiting for all this. So, lessons learned. For me personally, too, because this was a journey that took me quite a few years, probably a decade from dabbling in the books that I was reading at my mother's to sitting down and poring over charts about what the Babylonians knew and didn't and what the Sumerians and the Chaldeans were doing. I think it's safe to say, when we're evaluating anything, claims for very, very sophisticated science and mathematics in great antiquity, we are talking thousands and thousands of years ago, are dodgy. I've read books that try to convince me that the Vedic era culture and the subcontinent of India had the nuclear weapons because of such and such as a palm and a layer of glass in the desert. I think it's safe to say they did not have nukes. Great sweeping claims about one culture providing the answer to everything are going to be wrong. And they're probably going to be very offensive in the same way that the Pan-Babylonians were offensive to basically every other culture coming out of the Mesopotamian region. You don't walk up to people and say, hey, you know, your sacred thing, you stole that. Your science, you stole that. You did. Anybody, same thing when you've got, it was a member of this club, a Lonian book, talking about China in the Middle Ages, the Chinese sent people, and they discovered this, and they discovered that. It's like, yeah, they had some pretty sophisticated stuff, and they had some pretty, they did not colonize South America. They just didn't. Good story, no. But the truth is complex, and it's messy, and it doesn't always make for a good narrative, just like science is often boring and repetitive, and doesn't make for a good whiz-bang, oh hey, everything changed, revelation. Big, beautiful, evocative ideas are seductive. Imagining an ancient zodiac created during some time when key constellations were perfectly aligned with the seasons, that's beautiful. The truth of a system being fine-tuned over the millennia by nameless scribes and nameless astrologers in court after court after court in places whose names have been lost to us, that's not exciting, that's not fun. And we like the idea that scientific truths are elegant. The idea of Occam's razor, the idea that the truth is going to be the simplest thing presented to us. And the answer may be elegant, but the way you get there is a mess. And creating something like the zodiac was a lengthy mess. So, these books. I have read some of these books. I recommend none of them. You can find them. Out of these, Arctos is probably, I stood out as being the best written, the most deeply offensive, because, well, they get into Nazis, okay? That gets offensive really fast. But they had this positive that you've got the world, and back in the day, there were people living at the North Pole, this culture called Hyperboreans, and they could live there because at that point, the Earth did not have a 23.5 degree axis, it had a straight up and down zero tilt axis, and the North Star had Polaris, had Ursa Minor swinging around it in this beautiful configuration directly overhead of these magical northern people. Can we agree none of this ever happened?
We're throwing in things.
Okay, we were in crazy land with this. But, you know, I read this book when I was about 16. There were some pretty interesting images in there. No, none of that. No ancient astronauts, no mythraic mysteries, unless there was a mythraic church. No, it's not like this. And definitely no people living at the North Pole when the Earth doesn't have a 23.5 axis tilt. Further reading? Read at your own risk. There's some interesting stuff that gets into debunking the Pan-Babylonian school, which, if you really want to get into that, I can recommend that. I do recommend Stern Names, The Lore and Meaning by R.H. Allen, that book that started me off with the idea that there was a sixth constellation zodiac, because it's a fun book, and you know that you're reading something dated. You know that you're reading something where this guy's throwing all kinds of stuff into the mix. And along the way, you will learn fascinating things about the names of stars, the names of constellations, and the body of thought that was available to him at the time that he was compiling with this. So as a classic of outdated astronomical literature, that's some good stuff. Anything else? Yeah, no. Speculative section of the bookstore, no. And so the ultimate answer that we've got is, science is hard work, does not make for a good story, and we still really don't know how some of these things, like the zodiac, really started. You know what they coalesced, but no, we will never know, probably, who started them. It's just, in the end, a good story. Any questions?
I have a question about several sides back. Something.
Oh, sure.
Greek constellation. I think it's maybe a typo. Something about Greek constellations 3000 BC.
Let me see.
It was on the right before the Persian. Right? The side before this. Two. No. Next. It was the Persian. Next
slide. Oh yeah, that one.
What does that mean, classical Greek constellations sailor?
You know, I meant 300. Thank you for pointing that out. That was supposed to be 300, yes. Any other questions? And I really can't see you all.
Diane?
Yes.
Anytime we hear these stories of ancient civilizations that were predicting these phenomena with no written language, no mathematics, no nothing, that's essentially all bunk.
Okay, so keep in mind that we're focusing here on a particular tradition that did have a written language. And we do have the texts. Precisely. So I'm not going to, not having studied, say, Polynesian astronomy extensively, I'm not going to ask any predictions about what they did or didn't understand. Obviously, they used the stars for navigation. Obviously, they had no written language, and they were masters of oral storytelling and communicating information through, basically, you know, poetry. Obviously, the ancient Greeks went through a period where they were doing things in poetic form, which is why we've got the Iliad and the Odyssey, both of which contain astronomical references that at various times people used to turn into all kinds of theories. So, as far as being able to understand the world, I'm not going to say no, it's not possible, but as far as doing math without writing, that does seem to me to be pretty hard. And if we're talking about the cultures where we know that they had a written language, whether it's the Egyptians, the Sumerians, the Akkadians, you can trace the evolution of what they were doing in their own worlds and say, no, these claims aren't true. I take it you encountered that a bit at Outreach?
No, not too much, but I mean, I also had a childhood. I mean, I used to watch every single Alien, you know, all of that stuff. I mean, that's really how I got into astronomy.
And there's nothing wrong with that. I think a lot of us got here through,
that. Arthur C. Clarke's old show with all the mysteries. I mean, that was my jam. But
the mysteries fire up your imagination.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right. It's more aesthetically pleasing than the truth.
Ken?
How about the parallel thought process that went into the Chinese cultures and into the other cultures of the time that were back at that era? Is there any intertwine between the travels of explorers and so on and so forth, which brought in like a plow for the first of my years?
I dabbled in that a little bit. And at least as far as the sources I was looking at, it was very hard to untangle what happened between different periods of contact. And instead of the Chinese, I'll use that, the example that you give of the Dogon people, who this star-worshipping culture that allegedly had knowledge of Sirius B, the telescopic white dwarf orbiting Sirius before contact with Europeans. And when you look at that and say, no, actually the contact existed and the information was exchanged and people adapted. So when you have cultures that may have had these points of contact separated by a very long time, and as far as I went with the Chinese angle, it was very difficult to determine at which point the cross-pollination really occurred and what was, say, maybe original thought and what was simply passed back and forth. It's hard.
Sure.
So I would love to get deeper into that because the little bit I saw was fascinating and very, very frustrating. Anyone else? Yes, Steve.
Yeah, some of your worst references remind me of the very first, and I use this term loosely, astronomy book that I ever read. What is it?
I wasn't going to go there, but you went there. Yes.
So I apparently survived the experience.
He's special. He's real special. I think I spent a summer on my lunch break at work. I was working in an anatomy lab then, and I was reading debunkings of von Däniken all summer long because I could not believe that this stuff was published and that people were paying money for it.
So we had a copy in the house.
So did we. We had chariots of the gods.
I don't know if I made it to the end of it.
Okay. Von Däniken I found to be particularly unreadable. So with him it was more like a wow, how could anybody believe this? Which is some of these other things, they were written well enough that you could start to think, well, maybe that could happen. And that's how they get you, is that speculative fiction. It gets you on the hook of, could it be? And that's actually one of those buzzwords that you have to look out for when you're reading something in a new era. Maybe about Chinese and Western cross-pollination, could it be? And that's the jumping off point for the really, in some cases actually, I would think, dangerous ideas.
Yeah, I think I didn't catch the Various references, like Venus coming out of Jupiter. I had no idea what the heck he was talking about. But I had to have been single digits in age when I read it. So I apparently moved on. I don't know, maybe the golden book of astronomy or something, one of those, which isn't a story and probably didn't capture my imagination even a little.
Yeah, one of the guys that I read a lot when I was a teenager, and that his way of doing it was, he would go to some site in the field and he would debunk this story about ancient astronauts or aliens building pyramids or what have you. And then he would slip in his own crazy story, and since it's already out there, he's still debunking things. Wow, this guy's legit, right? He's actually doing his research. Ooh, maybe the Phoenicians did get to Australia. Yeah, they're clever. It is clever stuff. Anyone else? Yes, in the back.
So you backtracked and found kind of the starting points of the zodiac. How far back does the BS that's attached to him go, as far as like, you're a Taurus, oh, you're this, you're a, you know, is that much more modern than we give it credit for? It would be my assumption.
Most of the bad ideas that I was actively investigating were 19th century in origin. And I'll just be blunt with you guys, they tie into some nasty stuff. It ties into the theories of race that were at the time. It ties into the theories of eugenics. There are some virulent strains of anti-Semitism in this stuff. And that's what makes it so toxic, when you get these beautiful ideas that, again, catch your imagination, is the people selling them in some cases are really bad people. So most of what I was looking at was that late 19th century, Bismarck's Prussia, late Victorian era, where this stuff was coming out of. And it was definitely based on some really bad science at the time, like, you know, perverted strains of Darwinism and things like that. So it very much a product of the era. And there somebody, Jonathan, did you have your hand up again?
I did. So do you have any idea which the oldest constellations are and which legitimately date back to the earliest period of the Babylonian world?
I wanted to find that answer, and I cannot confidently say. Because really, the earliest constellations may be the Egyptian ones that have nothing whatsoever to do with the Mesopotamian tradition that we've got. They just kind of exist on their own island. So as far as what somebody in the Euphrates Valley would have first pegged as a constellation, I cannot confidently say at this point.
Well, apparently they really like Orion's Belt.
Anyone else? Yes, Bob?
I don't believe in astrology, but Libras tend to be skeptics.
That's a good one. Yes?
So what you're saying, Diane, is the normal Greek mythology started about 300 BC.
A little earlier than that, depending on, because so we've got a tradition of that's passed to us through, let's just call them Homer, whoever assembled those poems, and those are treasure troves of what we think are earlier myths stitched together that may have their roots prior to the basically the Greek equivalent of the Dark Ages. And then we get into, I would say, from what I remember, I would say the writings of Hesiod, which 7th century BC might be where we start seeing what we think of as Greek myths as Greek myths. But the Romans repackaged a lot of them. I mean, a huge amount of what we think of Greek myths is actually Ovid writing to entertain a Roman aristocratic audience, and it's got nothing to do with what, you know, Hesiod and his contemporaries were actually trying to communicate. So the pieces are there. and you can certainly make these parallels with the Babylonian texts of the time. Okay, we can correlate this god to this god and this god to this god. You can see this bit of Gilgamesh that does seem to tie into this part of Genesis. But there's part of the way that they get you with the pseudoscience is you do have this barbarous age in Greece where you've got this gap between the heroes that Homer was writing about and Homer himself. And you know that there's these nuggets of more ancient information contained in these classical poems. Well, they had to come from somewhere, so what's the text going even farther back and farther back? I mean, Jonathan asked about a constellation. One of the earliest things that we've got on record is the Hyades, which we don't consider a constellation, but it's the V in Taurus. That has a very well-attested history. And so when we talk about what constellations were they recognizing, well, we know from the Bible, from Homer, they were seeing the Hyades, they were seeing the Pleiades. Those things were key objects in the sky. They're just not what we think of today as official constellations.
I'd like about 3 minutes on the election, if you don't mind.
Absolutely. So we've got a few minutes, and if anybody wants to talk to me more about crazy stuff, the Red Coat Tavern is down the road on Woodward, just north of 13 Mile, and I'll be happy to talk to you over a beer. And since Ken would like to talk about the elections and they're very important, I will happily yield the floor.